We discovered payments to federal colleges, secondary schools for school feeding amounting to 2.67 billion during the lockdown when children were not in school, and some of this money we traced ended up in personal accounts. We have arrested those who are involved and investigations are ongoing to what, who they fed when children were at home and there was a lockdown. Our focus on revenue generating agency, based on our collaboration with the Office of the Auditor General of the Federation, has focused on revenue generating agency but has been delayed by COVID-19 lockdown. We are currently doing two focal agencies, namely the Federal Inland Revenue and the Nigerian Customs, for this pilot stage. As with 2019, sir, we did some personnel and capital budget utilization review, focusing on health and education sectors. In the health sector, about 52 institutions were reviewed, and we found again about surplus of 4.6 billion on personnel costs, which we recommended to the Honorable Minister of Finance to be restrained from abuse, except the agencies were able to offer credible explanations. We still discovered abuse of personnel costs by some officers on the GiveMe platform, most notably the Usman Damfodio University Teaching Hospital, where 227 million was diverted by a young man of 28 years old from the surplus personnel cost without the knowledge of his superior and management. He used technology and we brought him to our office to show us exactly what he did. We noticed for some improvements, sir, in the health institutions that we looked at compared to 2019 in their utilization of funds and compliance with due process. Nevertheless, we wish to humbly suggest, sir, that our recommendations on reallocation of funds to health institutions are yet to be carried out by government, and we urge that this should be done. It will assist these institutions to better meet their fiscal and transparency standards and relieve them of some of the challenges responsible for perennial default and susceptibility to investigation. We strongly recommend that visitation teams should be appointed to these health tertiary institutions and federal medical centers to conduct a performance and personnel audit on them and to determine the actual number of personnel required for optimum performance, because we keep finding them claiming personnel that we are not persuaded exist. It is anomalous, for example, to find that some federal medical centers have more personnel than teaching hospitals. We also recommend that government should properly define what is internally generated revenue and provide adequate overhead allocations and funding for the outsourced services of these institutions from what we are very sure are the inevitable savings from personnel costs when the audit is done. On the education sector, sir, in view of our collaboration with the Auditor General, we reviewed infractions that the Auditor General found in his 2017 report, and we selected about 78 education sector MDAs which are being reviewed. The common findings are payment again of bulk sums to staff accounts, including so-called project funds. As I said, oftentimes the first casualty is tax, because tax is never paid by those individuals. Whereas if the proper track had been followed, government will earn the tax revenue that is projected for. We noticed non-deduction and remittance of taxes and IGR, payment of unapproved allowances, bulk payments to microfinance banks. Some of these institutions pay money to microfinance banks because many of those microfinance banks are not covered by this BVN policy. We're hoping that the CBN will extend the BVN policy and government will extend the BVN policy to them so that we can track very quickly. I will move very quickly to other areas of our work. The ethics and integrity scorecard on MDAs was designed to identify institutional weaknesses that promote corruption in the public service. In spite of the pandemic and restrictions, the Commission deployed the scorecard on 352 MDAs nationwide. Findings from this survey, as is also included in the pack that are before your excellencies, it is clear that we noticed that financial management scored slightly better. And the reason for this is because government had insisted on the automation of transactions through GiveMe, TSA, IPs, and Remita. and e-platform. Unfortunately, the area that scored low was on management, culture and structure and administrative system. We find out that abuse takes place because this area is yet to be strengthened. We urge that government will strengthen the administrative and management structures so that it will complement the financial management infrastructure that government has put in place. In the list that we have published, we've showed the corruption risks, MDAs, and those that scored very well. On asset recovery, sir, the Commission has, in the process of its enforcement measures based on intelligence, recovered some sums of money. For example, early in the year, we seized about 16 billion from the Federal Ministry of Agric because the money was moved under suspicious circumstances below the threshold that will enable to, that will put it under the purview of the Accountant General or other anti-corruption agencies. Furthermore, some of the money we found was paid into some personal accounts and used for non-official purposes. Although investigations are ongoing, delayed due to COVID-19, the bulk of the money restrained in CBN was released in the peak of the pandemic when the ministry appealed to the Commission that it needed to make palliatives available to Nigerians to reduce the effect of COVID-19. The Commission and the Office of the Accountant General of the Federation are tracking the use of these funds to ensure that there is value for money. On another note, we found that some contractors were paid for jobs not done or deliberately overpaid for jobs done, and the excess was shared by the contractors and some of the defaulting officers. One individual from the ministry, who is now deceased, appropriated over 2.5 billion to himself and his cronies. I will skip some of the other assets that we have recovered, and I go quickly towards our effort at public education and enlightenment. Your Excellency will recall that in 2019 we pledged to involve communities and citizens in project monitoring. In fulfillment of that pledge, sir, we launched the My Constituency, My Project nationwide, during which we sensitized and enlisted community ownership. We also accompanied that by publishing a toll-free line through which Nigerians can call in to our office to find out the projects that government has allocated for their constituency. And we are happy to report that this has worked very well, but there's still much more to be done. We also published a leaflet breaking down zonal intervention projects by sector, by state, and by region in order to guide the public from tracking what government is doing for themselves to reduce the complaint that they have been abandoned. To boost community involvement for our 20th anniversary, we launched in July the 20 million from ICPC at 20 project, with two main competitions aimed at provoking youth creativity and support for the fight against corruption. These were the National Music Competition and the National Essay Competition for junior and secondary schools with anti-corruption or integrity clubs. ICPC will give out 20 million prize money with the kind support of Makato Foundation. Your Excellency, sir, I wish to use this opportunity to thank the Makato Foundation and its country director, Dr. Collier Ahmed Shettima, for his invaluable and generous support to ICPC in particular and Nigeria in general. I will, in the course of this event, sir, introduce the winners of the competitions and those of the public sector and integrity awardees. Your Excellency, sir, we're delighted that Mr. President will today launch the National Ethics and Integrity Policy as one of the milestones for Nigeria at 60 and ICPC at 20. We're delighted to have initiated and actively worked on this policy with stakeholders from the Office of the Secretary to the Government of the Federation and the National Orientation Agency to return Nigerians to the values of old that made Nigeria great from north to south, east to west, and that promoted values that are cherished by Mr. President. The Ethics and Integrity Policy is a follow-up to previous initiatives of the Commission, such as the establishment of the Anti-Corruption and Transparency Unit in 2002 and the development of the National Values Curriculum for Teaching, which has been introduced since 2012. This policy is a befitting follow-up to these initiatives, and we again thank those who have partnered with us for doing this. Sir, let me end my speech by extending the profound gratitude of the Commission, its management and staff to Mr. President, sir, for your leadership and for your support to the work of the Commission. Your unequivocal stand against corruption is a morale booster to the fight against corruption. Without your stand and positioning, the message will be diluted to do or not to do. This is not the case with you, sir. Your message is clear. If we do not kill corruption, corruption will kill Nigeria.